conversations about, while we're presenting the festival and all the amazing work, how this work gets made, what goes into supporting and making the work, and how do we support the artists, and how do we just keep the conversations happening. And to have that in tandem with seeing the work is sort of, you know, quite the curtain to see what's happening behind it a little bit. And I'm so happy that Andy's back here and the amazing speakers that we have for the next 2 weekends. So we will be having these cultural sessions from noon to 1:30, the Saturday, tomorrow, and then the following weekend also. It's also going to be streamed live on HowlRound TV, and that's Jamie Galoon and everybody who just waved. So this means that this is being streamed, so if you're not happy about that, either, I don't know, stand behind the camera or go to the other side of the computer, I guess. So welcome again. The festival runs for 2 weeks, and you'll find information about the festival downstairs with lots of materials, but I'm going to give you back to Andy. So Andy, please.
So how's everybody doing?
Good.
Right on. I wanted to start thanking again, and there's this guy, Mark Russell. I don't know if any of you know him.
Oh, that guy.
That guy. So he's over there, and he found it under the radar, and he also made Culturebot possible, and I used to work for him at PS122, and he was just raising up the same kind of sort of go through that internet thing. And 10 years later, we're here. And so I just, so big round of applause for Mark. Just a quick note, two quick notes. We were up at the APAC, the uptown, the midtown, where the fancy pants folks are. And where Culturebot and the Invisible Dog Arts Center launched the Brooklyn Commune Project. So and that's all about arts and economics and cultural production. Go to brooklyncommune.org. There's reports around. There's people with buttons that can tell you about that project. You can get a button. So those people are going to tell you about that. There's events and stuff. And all of this is kind of related. This today is a discussion about art and technology. We've got some amazing people here as invited guests, but we are using a format, sort of modified version of Lovis Weaver's The Long Table. It's a sort of like open participatory format. We've modified it because a lot of the things that we tackle are pretty like big ideas, so we like to sort of have some invited guests to sort of really get things rolling. But this is the etiquette guide. You know, if you feel moved to like speak, or you're like, I gotta say something, the only real rule is like come to the table and take a seat. It's hard to not talk from there, but try and like actually physically come here. If there is not a seat, you're welcome to ask somebody for their seat. They don't have to give it to you. The idea is that it's like a dinner party conversation, but the food is apples and conversation. And I also want to, before we get started, I want to give a big, big thanks to Bill O'Brien, who's here from the NEA. Bill organized a talk with a number of these people that just happened up at the hotel, and has been a great person to bounce ideas off of, and so I just thank you very much for helping make this possible.
Thank you.
All right, so I guess I'm going to sit down and start and then go away.
As I mentioned with Mark, like about Mark, like 10 years ago I started going, I was like, oh, this internet thing, I knew just enough HTML to be dangerous. You know, I did, in the late 90s, I could make a website and about this magic. But obviously, we've come a long way since then. And when it comes to performance, it seems like, we're in this whole new world, really, where technology not only sort of enhances or expands or redefines sort of the nature of what can happen in performance. It also asks a lot of questions about liveness and where performance even happens, dramaturgical structures, you know, so I thought I would just sort of open up the table a little bit about, you know, one of the things that I really find myself asking a lot is like, what is the importance of liveness, and sort of what is the relationship, like how you feel like when you're thinking about this work, like what do you think about the relationship between the liveness and the live medium and sort of media, the like, digital space.
I feel very passionate about what you just said, and Bill told me that I would feel this intense passion. So I'm happy to jump right in there with you because I come from a performance background, experimental theater wing and Tisch, very your body rolling around the walls, making it in the studio, and then I ended up being in a show. I was in song for 6 years and it had this incredible energy. So I understand what it means to something that cannot be replaced visually ever in the history of being human, and that is having your molecules vibrate with the sound that somebody else is making, or having you the same, whatever that energy is in the space. But then I also was frustrated by spending all my time, energy, and money into the 3 month, 4 month, 6 month process of creating and birthing this baby called like the performance of whatever it was, and then I love it that it's a moment and then disappears. And it's only moment that the people in that room share, but I also wanted some art, some kind of artifact around it, some kind of just connectedness with others, and I was jealous of filmmakers for that. I was like, they have something that lives, that is, you know, it has an audience that reaches beyond, and this is all happening in the 90s, right? So then all of a sudden, this little thing called, you know, the internet, so now I'm in this space where I'm like, I love the fact that we went through a period where all of our digital was like stuck at a PC and there was no mobility in it. And now we have this thing called mobility with our connectedness. And so then it kind of facilitates ritual, then it facilitates being in real spaces, but connected at the same time. The challenge is how people are in those spaces not looking at a screen, but you know, how does the story that evolved before come drive into happening and then exist afterwards? How does it, you know, how do you use screens in augmented ways? There's technology in the pipeline where there will be no screens in 5 years. So how do we play with that? How do we play with Google Glass? I don't know if that's going to work or not work. Two people present and physical, yet connected and individual. But I'm really excited about what that could be so that we don't have to choose one or the other.
So let's complicate it a little bit further. All right. So digital molecules. You know, this really kind of weird arbitrary separation between the virtual and the non-virtual, as if it's some sort of sacrosanct space to preserve, as if it's somehow going to, or we're hanging our humanity on it, or hanging the arts on it, seems really kind of misguided to me, because I think it's fairly clear that the convergence is here, it's happened. You know, the convergence of biology and digital is now. And so that changes the entire paradigm of what we're even talking about in terms of even using terms like liveness. What does that mean?
I also think it's a false, Andy, it's a false dichotomy between liveness and something that is mediated. I don't think that we have ever lived at, or enjoyed, participated in performances or events without some kind of a mediation. So if we are always already mediated, or if we are always already in a mediated situation, then liveness as such becomes a difficult thing to articulate conceptually and actually. But I do agree with you that there are some real values about the liveness of this event, the fact that we can see each other, or sort of see each other, I don't think we want to run away from the fact that there are some values that comes from liveness, but I would not want to make the distinctions between the live and the virtual or the mediated too stark, because I think that we might be missing a whole range of opportunities to collaborate and to interact and to, you know, play at the fuzzy edge if we see this as an important distinction.
Well, the reason I asked the question is that, I agree with you, is that
is that it's not to necessarily privilege one over the other, but rather to work to suggest that there is work to be done in defining the unique characteristics of each. And I think that, you know, like, I mean, we've all found over the 15 years of using the internet that, like, email doesn't support a certain type of conversation, or, you know, different media, like the process of mediation inherently changes the nature of the communication. So I'm not, it's not about privilege. I think we're all pretty comfortable moving in sort of a horizontal world in which things exist across different platforms in different ways. The question is rather what are the, my question is rather what are the particular characteristics of that? What are the particular characteristics and what are the effects of mediation? And how do we consider that dramaturgically? And I'd actually like to throw that over to Yehuda a little bit.
What was the question?
Because I think your project, The Ascent, which is now something else called, like it feels to me like it talks a lot about like, the live experience, but it's also like monitoring what's happening in your head, and sort of I'm just curious about like you're thinking about like what you would construct, and it's performance that people watch, but it's also performance that happens in your head, so it's like that relationship.
Yeah. The Ascent is a mind, it's run on your brain waves, and we use a brainwave sensor to strap you into a harness, and you have to focus to levitate yourself to the top of the room, and you can win. It's a game.
Is that RPI?
It was at RPI, and then we did it in Brooklyn a year ago, a couple years ago. And it's a game, so you can win. If you get into the zone, you get to the top, and the Gates of Kiev by Mussorgsky starts playing, and confetti cannons go off, and the sun comes up. So it's completely generated by you and your mind state in order to make it work. And it's taking this very internal, very human process of engaging with your own mind and just becoming totally present. And when people say, well, how do you do it? The best way that I can describe it is just to say, well, you have to just totally relax, but at the same time be alert and very present. And when you do that, you're affecting this huge installation. You know, there's a lot of sound and lighting. There's an array of subwoofers that are, you know, there's a lot of different points of feedback. So the way that I always think about it is this internal human process is then being, there's this, you know, translational mechanism, which is the EEG and then all the software that we've written. And then that human element is then becoming translated into digital and creating an amazing show for everyone that's watching.
Well, no, you just made, I finally figured out what, because it feels like the tension when I did it is that one is sort of almost trying to cultivate a quiet mind, while at the same time, your inability to cultivate a quiet mind or your ability to do that makes more stuff happen on the outside. So in a way, you're like embodying that tension.
Which is exactly what everybody goes through the minute before they go on stage on anything.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. And that's why we found that performers are actually really kind of good at it. And producers not so good at it. Performers are good at it because it's very similar to a state of mind that you need to be in when you're on stage, which is completely relaxed and open, but at the same time, completely relaxed and calm, but at the same time very alert and open to anything.
So we've had this conversation over the last, I don't know, 18 months or so, and it's I end up feeling somewhat conflicted by it. I feel in some ways it's worth noting that there's something very specific about live human interaction that we need to, maybe now with more urgency than we did before, understand what that is and how it can be employed and all of that. At the same time, I do feel like, and I'm not necessarily saying I'm hearing this from you, but sometimes we can get so afraid of technology and how it might be sapping us from our humanity. And when you think about it, I mean, anything that we've done in arts involved technology all the way back to 40,000 years ago when somebody turned a vulture bone into a flute. That was a technologist who then played with it in a way to create beauty and meaning. And I think in some ways, we're so fascinated by these new capabilities that it could be an app for just about anything we can dream of in a minute. We wouldn't be surprised to hear that there's an app for something that's actually impossible, but who knows? But when we start to become less amazed just by the capability and more sort of dedicated to thinking about how do we now express ourselves with this new stuff. In the same way that, you know, Gutenberg, you know, that changed everything. We're in one of those big changes right now, which is confusing.
Take me a second to figure out what liveness means to me, but I mean, I think one thing why it still is a significant thing is that, you know, we all like and want to be in places where our presence matters, right? And I think ultimately, we are, as humans, we're sensual a lot of games. And I think that the theater and communal kind of activity serves that need. And I think what's really exciting about the current sort of state of technology media is that the sort of spectrum of like live and not live really is now this really fascinating spectrum where we're really, a lot of what we're seeing is targeting like, it's not really live, it's about presence and co-presence on scales, like on massive co-presence scales. And it opens up all of these like kind of sub-spaces of live-like experiences and that are totally on steroids because of like what the network can do. And when like the network kind of merges with the body, that's when it gets really exciting when these conundrums are introduced. I think, you know, like coming out of the 90s and the 80s, I think a lot of that, for me, that the interesting intersection was about how like media, primarily visual media, like obvious media, was like impacting the body, that was driving kind of artistic expression. But I think now, for me, the most interesting stuff is where it's actually become invisible, and where it's not so much about meeting image or video or sound, but it's actually now the body's intersecting with algorithm, and that's really changing how we communicate, and also these really fascinating issues of dramaturgy, like network dramaturgy or distributed dramaturgies, and how that's impacting creation and economics, education, and sort of all of that.
That's a giant path. That's interesting. You're talking about, you know, embodying algorithm. That's certainly something that I'm looking into. The piece that I recently premiered called Botch was an ensemble called the Broken Word Opera, but it was an ensemble piece for four performers that primarily are vocalists, and the idea was to be as low tech as possible with the technology that we use. We did use microphones, but we used some fairly contemporary algorithms as far as how we expressed our vocal lines. The score was written algorithmically as flowcharts and diagrams and a lot of if-then statements and conditionals, and a lot of what they were doing was processing information as it got streamed to them in real time, but it was being streamed by another live voice. So this idea of, you know, looking at the algorithm in a more embodied way seemed to get at maybe perhaps a deeper level of what technology is really doing, maybe in a wider sense, rather than focusing on a particular technology or particular device.
Well, that gets back to what we were just talking about. DARPA, they're looking at narrative and empathy, and they're looking at it in a very quantitative way, and they're looking at it as a tool to go into a place where you should have shared purpose, but we don't trust each other, so how can you reduce the likelihood of bias? And they want to look
as a weapon.
Well, that is a very interesting
point. Right. I mean, that's the dichotomy.
Right.
The weaponization of empathy.
The weaponization of empathy, which is
the weaponization of empathy.
Yeah.
I'm just repeating that so everyone heard that. The weaponization of empathy.
I wouldn't say that to them. But
no.
Because is that dual-edged sword of what's going on? Because these technologies are great, these algorithms, how we can interact directly. We have to understand both sides of how it's operating, because on one hand, with the recent NSA revelations, these algorithms are being used to track and control people in a major way. The way that corporations use algorithms is done very intentionally for the same way.
Right.
Even though the public discourse isn't really about that. But that's where we get into what I think is the hacker mentality, that I think is a different way of using those tools to sort of upend peacefully structures and power dynamics to keep the gears and flow of ideas moving.
In check.
And yeah, exactly. I think that's one of the wonderful and unique things that the arts have to offer. They can also be used to keep our minds closed by showing us what we already want to see, but they can also be used very powerfully to keep rupturing that idea.
Well, that's a cool thing. I mean, that's what raises an interesting question I'd like to ask. You know, because totally unique thing is like one of the things that I find like as I go between worlds, it's just, it seems like people actually often are in a similar place that the vocabularies are very difficult to bridge. And I'm wondering about sort of the relationship of cognition, and you're sort of talking about like embodied and, you know, and the way like the Diebes ex machina was an actual machine. But narrative, and machines have changed, but like our approach to like narrative as a linear thing hasn't really, and even until recently, and even sort of like, you know, Rashomon style multiple narratives are still constructed using a linear thing. Whereas I think what you're talking about with multiple network dramaturgies, or like Joe with Botch and now with Wow, where you're using algorithms to sort of like deconstruct and problematize the nature of narrative, is there a sort of cognitive component about that that to play with the hacking thing that we can sort of hack our cognition?
Well, I think that's one of the most interesting things about the idea of democratization of story and who is the tell story, who is the storyteller, and where the artist's role is in democratization of storytelling. How we need craftsmanship. You know, when YouTube and Google all being generated and democratization started, there was this threat of the artist and the expertise, especially the one that's kind of done up here in our art schools. You know, where do we fit if there's so much of our eyes are focused on, you know, low rent kind of, you know, creation of the masses in storytelling, and that's where people are going for their storytelling. And but now we're starting to see even the transmedia activism that there's a core group of enthusiasts that will jump into this kind of crowdsourced storytelling dynamic, but that you need somebody to create a story world that has the rules of the algorithms or whatever, so that you have an experience that is successful, hopefully, no matter which way you come into it. And that doesn't mean highly produced, but it means successful in terms of catharsis or meaning or resonance, whatever that is. But I think what I'm interested about that is that there is this thing, this is very postmodern too, but there's a thing called truth. What is that? You know, what is truth, right? And it's something that's dynamic and it doesn't stay still for a second, but get a better sense of understanding of it through the storytelling of the masses, but the digital tools you have to synthesize that in ways that can help us consume that without having to actually, you know, it's too overwhelming to just experience all of it, but there's a way that it all comes together. You have happenstance, you can experience some of the micro stories, and you also have these kind of dynamization tools and things that allow you to understand what is this mass. What is the meta story? What is the macro story that, as human beings, are living, are experiencing, or we need to tell, or we need to share? And so, in terms of cognition, I'm interested in that because so much of our narrative creates our reality, right? The implicit bias work that they're doing at Harvard, where they literally are showing us how, you know, not many Americans can associate positive words with fat people, quote unquote, or positive words with Muslim people, quote unquote, or positive words with black people. Like, no matter how activist you are, no matter how, even if you are fat, Muslim, and black, you still are going to, quote unquote, have this prime of negativity towards those stereotypes, because we're primed through story and through imagery to do that. And the beauty of the democratization of storytelling and the mass data that we can tap into, if done right and crafted by people, like you said, with the hacker mentality, we can get closer to what might be that more dynamic, complex, diverse point of what you.
I think the multiple points of entry you're talking about, I think is perhaps a if I make a very broad generalization, perhaps an effect of computer interface on our lives, where we really, things aren't fed to us in such a linear way anymore. It's more like you go to the subject or the material and click around or poke around on the internet or wherever, and I think. With once your brain maybe gets slightly rewired in that way, and you find yourself in a live performance space, perhaps you're not waiting for the thing to get dictated to you, you know, like you're being pulled along, you know, by a string the whole time. Or maybe you're more like in an environment where you're free to cognitively, you know, poke around and kind of see what you want. And I think, I mean, obviously that's been in the air in performance for perhaps 100 years at least, in terms of thinking about authorship, you know, being partly the audience, really. But I think now it's really happening, not just in sort of the art competency or whatever, but like, you know, I think everyone going into a lot of situations looks at a lot of situations, not for a linear narrative, but something they can look around. And I think someone who's creating or facilitating a performance work, I think lots of people are, and I sort of take it into account when I'm creating art. I'm, you know, giving the space for that.
Seems like one of the big opportunities here is, well, first off, a recognition that cognition is changing. I mean, the neurophysiology is changing. I think that's unquestionable. And it's in part due to the multitasking, this facilitation of the culture in which we are situated and the adaptation that's coming with that. So it's no wonder that you know, we've come into these environments with expectations of a different form of interaction and ability to express ourselves and be part of that expression. But it seems to me like one of the big opportunities in all of this is not then falling back into a more traditional way of thinking about how stories emerge, and that possibility of rule systems about rule systems becomes a way of structuring a different kind of narrative that allows the narrative itself to emerge itself. So the data wants to be free, folks.
And then if we really think about like the across the eons value of the arts and why is it there, culture and stuff, holding a mirror up to nature. And when nature is changing, if the nature of our cognitive physical makeup is changing, then really it's up to you guys to kind of play around with that and show us back what's going on. And I think Clive Thompson, has a book out now about, he's talking about how our brains are changing, but we don't have to remember stuff. So that allows us to kind of function in a much more sort of scanning a bunch of things. And that alarms some people, but he's saying, actually, this could be a really big asset. And he points out that Socrates was dead against the written word, because he thought, as soon as somebody writes something down, they don't have to know it anymore. And he made some comment about the worst dinner party mate would be somebody who writes stuff down, because he's not going to be equipped to just talk.
Yeah, well, it's true. I mean, I think that, you know, I think a lot about the nature of attention, you know, and I think with the invention of the book, we moved into one thing away from oral storytelling.
Right.
I think, you know, one of the things that always comes
folk music and recorded music.
Yeah, you know, the player piano, they say, you know, really wrecks the home life in a lot of ways. Yeah, so I mean, we're all, you know, not well, retrospectively wrecked, but I mean, you know, it's a changing. I think to the thing about the struggle, sorry, I'll get all this stuff. You know, like the Booster Group, like Hans T. Sleeman, like they've been doing sort of like collage, cut pieces, as he did for a long time. The idea of having to make meaning out of disparate things and juxtaposition for a long time. I think what's exciting to me is that with the computing power and the sort of like advanced technologies, we can bring a sort of whole other level of like complexity and thinking and intentionality to it. That's why I'm trying to keep coming back to you. But the Millie to Millie thing, telling you how that's constructed?
Sure, it's very much in process. We're in residency right now, collaboration between myself and theater director David Levine and Christian Hockey, who's a poet. And we're doing an opera based on Millie to Millie, based on, you know, the scandal that happened, the lip syncing scandal for this. We're obviously very interested in the issue of liveness as it relates to technology. I'm very interested in this moment in the 80s when the digital is becoming mainstream, and in the music industry certainly, you know, records are being produced where half of it are MIDI tracks on a sequencer. This is the emergence of MIDI, you know, what is that? Drum machines, you know, this sort of thing. But I'm interested in the relationship between, you know, the record industry as technology, as algorithmic. Like the story we're telling is very much in the way that we're talking about, you know, the newer scenarios for people to experience, but they can take away a lot of what they want from it. The score itself is screaming to the performers. I don't know what the score is going to be moment to moment, and neither do the performers. If there's, again, the interface that I've set up, and this is actually much more high-tech than the project I was talking about before. In this case, I have video monitors with the orchestra and the singers are taking their notes from, basically, that are being generated from a database that's scrambled above or opera, and have each measure in there, and just gets spat out a little differently every time, but really according to very live context. It's not actually random. It's leaving it open so that I, as a composer, become more of a improviser and a performer, and can respond to, you know, what's been going on, the energy of the room, what I feel like that day, how the last piece went, if I need to go, you know, amp it up a little bit, have a little more density in this passage, you know, so that I can actually change things. Which, as a composer, is a very frustrating thing for anyone who's a composer. In a traditional sense, you sit in a concert and you hear something you composed a long time ago, and you're like, holy jeez. So that's how I'm using it there.
I joined the table and noticed also just even the difference between sitting at audience and sitting at table immediately changed my physicality in relationship to the conversation. And because of the conversation, I think I was more alert to that. And what I'm noticing is that I enjoy this kind of stuff because it like makes my head wig out. Like it goes really fast. It's like nerdery, what have you. And it's like very cerebral and intense, and I like that kind of stimulation to try to keep up, but also to have my mind blown by new thoughts. And so that's all cool, and I find myself sort of engaging with your question around liveness and picking up on the thread that you were sharing around return to ritual. So I live in New Orleans, where ritual is very much a valued part and not necessarily done for others, even if it's done in public space. So whether it's the Mardi Gras Indians and the months of building the beads and the feathers, or whether it's the, you know, St. Patty's Day parade where there's cauliflower, cabbage, and carrots and potatoes being thrown, you know, like there's just so many intricate ways. And in some ways, it also comes out of hidden because not allowed. I'm also from California in the San Francisco Bay Area, so I grew up with a lot of mariachi music and Cuban music and all these things we think of as participatory art. And when I think about indigenous urban or migrant culture, I spent a lot of years in hip hop too, but I'm just wanting to pull or ask you to pull a little on this thread of ritual, because somewhere in the middle is this interstitial space called dramaturgy and audience and live and we watch and stuff. But kind of before that, and it sounds like after that, is this place where we all play. And somewhere in there's an access question for me though, because as I'm trying to think about navigating access and economics for the urban indigenous forms in New Orleans, they're not playing in that space of grants and all that kind of stuff, right? They're playing amongst themselves, and they may or may not be accessing this new ritual space that you're talking about. And so I'm just wanting to pull on the thread that you're suggesting.
I think that's powerful and very complicated.
And I don't know the answers to all the answers.
But thoughts, you may have thoughts.
Talking at the APEC earlier.
Thank you.
Yeah, we were talking about
it's
about
fun
the,
here.
I love that idea. I love pointing that out. It's changed. We talk a lot about it in the story lab, like interaction is a different brain space and a different experiential relationship to story than the past. And we need both, we love both, but there is, and I describe it as when I used to, there was one moment I saw one show out of 1,000 that we actually all hit the rhythm at the same time, but we actually all stomped the exact same time. And it was only one out of 1,000 shows, but I felt that. And it was like, whoa! I mean, I thought I was going to have an out-of-body experience. I thought I was going to explode. It was so amazing to be on stage having that experience and feel that it's the center of the audience. It's a different space to be having that particular experience versus watching that experience, or even having that kind of center of that experience. And so I think we need to create space for all those to happen. And like you said, like you discussed this, that ritual that existed when I was And I think the thing that I love from my friends that are also in MIT too is that this digital stuff, like you said, it's just tools that make us more efficient at what we've always already done. Like it's not necessarily new. The idea of support storytelling is not new. The idea of immersive storytelling is not new. That it's just these digital, technology allows us to see into the brain waves that we all know we feel when we're in that state in a different way because you're, using it. So I'm very excited about this return virtual. The access issue is something that I think is a challenge. We know that smartphone technology is up 47% in the last year. Well, we know that there's plenty of places in the world that never have telemedicine infrastructure or even a computer infrastructure the way that they are now having smartphones in their pocket. So we know that there's access to audience that didn't exist even a year ago. The content, quote, or story can come to spaces that in weeks out of several years going to, Nairobi, and everybody has a phone. Everybody. They don't have, running water that they have. So, that's one device that's now a possible device, not a mobile device, that's living with people at all times. One of our projects, hashtag now, that the Transmedia project that is going to be filling out the blue Montana Diaries, which was a successful Transmedia project last year, that went to interact with Emmy. And Jay Bushman, the creator, he was like, I realize these are not new possible devices. I have to figure out how to handle those in audience for 24 hours a day for 6 months. And I figure out that character arc story, or not, a couple hours in the theater. So I do think there is access issues for sure, but I also think that if you don't understand how are adopting new infrastructure, they don't have to, they're not laying the brick and mortar foundations that we
One other thing that kind of light bulb went off, and how this connects to that whole Claiborne, the guy did some studies with HowlRound on passive arts consumption versus active arts making. And what he was pointing out is that we may overstress the difference there sometimes. And in terms of ritual, it occurs to me that one of the things about liveness is that there is something very personal between the people on the stage. They are doing it for you. They're there for you. I mean, sometimes divas don't feel that way. But there is something about that. The example that I think of is I produced a play that I was also sometimes in, but then had a long life and I watched a lot more than I was in. And there was one moment in this play where the whole stage is singing at the top of their lungs, and then suddenly the sound drops off and the deaf kid at the center of the stage is signing. And suddenly everybody understands and they didn't realize they actually were listening to him. And so there's this gasp, and it was very consistent and happened every night. When I was on stage, voicing for the kid, I was hitting my mark, signing my light, doing all of that stuff. But when I was in the audience, it impacted me every time I saw it. And I think there's something, there is something about the liveness of that, where these are people actually doing this orchestrated thing to get this to happen to you. And it's not a passive consumption thing. There's mental activity and there's molecular stuff going on.
Well, this is something it's really complicated, and I love that. In California, Professor Ramachandran is doing all this work on the mirror neuron, and we know that that there's non-technology related, cognitive operations that are happening. We haven't really totally unpacked what is happening,
Right.
So this. I'm really intrigued by what I'm trying to translate in my light bulb. I'm trying to translate is your energy proposition, and as the weaponization is just shit out of it. Your empathy proposition.
I push that back about.
Your ritual proposition and your access proposition, which is I'll just throw this out there. I wonder if part of the access piece might be about ubiquity. The more the technology gets created and filters out and just is around, the access problem might take care of itself on some level, I don't know.
or maybe it needs stimulus. I know. The other thing that I keep coming back to is with empathy, ritual, and with the Yehuda's experience piece is like, have you ever had a moment where like you actually experienced what it was like to be somebody else? And we keep locating the performance out there, but you know, every once in a while you'll have some experience where like your brain will flip this and realize, oh, that's what, you know, like I'll be, I'm not gonna say that, but like you'll be somewhere where like you're the only person that's like you. And you realize what it's like for other people who experience that all the time. Or, you know, and it's like, and now people like play, you know, World of Warcraft, they have this sort of like outside the body idea of being in a first person shooter, it's only shooting ever. But is it possible then to sort of create a like a ubiquitous, pervasive technological environment for deep, empathetic conversion?
Right.
I have to say that it's not my choice, but Emily, it's you, Miwa, because I love your work. I'm looking at you embodying some stuff. But, okay, so Nick Fortuna, I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with him, brilliant game designer and artist and storyteller. And he talked about this, especially we have such prejudice against gaming and the whole first-person shooter, Grand Theft Auto kind of debauchery of that in our space. And he described this one game, the controller vibrates when you hold the hand of the woman you're trying to save throughout the entire game. Anyone familiar with this game? Okay, so the remote control actually vibrates when you hold her hand, right? And the whole object of the game is to save her from this tyranny, whatever it is. And they set you up. And you have to not only invest like 2 hours into a theater experience, but you can invest 8 to 10 hours in a game life experience to try to save this woman. So you have a deep relationship with her. And then you have a physiological relationship with her because you have this sensory of holding her hand. And no matter how you play the game, she dies. And he said the first time he experienced that, he beat. So there is catharsis in that world. There is a way to feel that sense of embodiment, even though it's still external from you. And I think technology is trying so hard to make us singularity, like where you're actually kind of, it's on you and wherever the technology, but there is something in that experience that can be valuable if we're not prejudiced against it.
So Tracy Fullerton of USC and Bill, video artist, Viola, worked on the Walden game. So it's a video game with a Walden bot, which sounds absurd, you know, it's like unplug your computer and go watch the woods. But her whole point was that, how do we get people to actually metaphysically try to go where Walden was trying to go when he went to the pond, but virtually, and trying to lead you through that, and she's looking at her.
So, you know, for me, I was at a meeting at Accenture, a big tech company, you know, that evaluation was on a lot of emerging technology just last week. And in that presentation, you know, and I may get to be a little bit in the line here, up till today, 5 billion laptop applications have been created. Up till today, 3 trillion apps on your mobile phones have been created. It's exponentially ubiquitous. You know, I mean, it's moving to a kind of ubiquity of experience that's very different in terms of how one might manifest. Well, there's two levels of it. One is that when you're interacting with your phone, with your smartphone device, and in effect, it is a narrative. I mean, that's the way it's structured. Sense, you're playing the phone. So you're in that game already. But another way of thinking about it is each one of those apps it requires a sort of short-term thinking. You know, there isn't necessarily the opportunity to play out that kind of more classic performance that requires the investment that one places into an experience. Experience can be very, very short. So, you know, of course, you're standing at Starbucks and you're playing the game, and that pressure. Yeah, it's like, boom, 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 latte, please. You know, you move on, and it's over. And it's that kind of ubiquity where it's just all the time, ever present. I'm in it, out of it, in it, out of it. It's part of the flow of everyday life. It's not something that's external that you sort of step into and step out of. Or it's parcel of being human.
So the question that comes up for me in that is like,
you know, like, go back to the Greeks. Oral tradition, I'm sorry, but it's like, but in a way, like, it existed in the pre-technological internet.
Right.
Like, it existed in myth, right? And myth is sort of like the internet before technology invents it. Because it's this cloud, it's this collectively owned, imaginative cloud and repository of ideas. And before it was passed out orally and then it was written down and stuff like that, so we have this sort of incredible long arc. And sometimes I think that, like, the tragedy of human images is bad knowledge. So is there then a tension between this constant sort of pervasive short-term ubiquitous technological experience and an inability, or does that, are these either or is the relationship that between then how do we sort of cognitively aggregate our experience and knowledge over time?
I think that's a really good question, and but perhaps it's not an either or kind of, you know, thing. I mean, what it may do is actually free up live experience to be the other, to be something, you know, more than what it has.
Sometimes I think we go to theater sometimes, or a movie, or a short-term experience, because you go into it, and often, not the theater so much, but with films, and even on, like, oh, what was that I just saw, and everything. On my way here today, before I came here, I picked up my 8-year-old son from a sleepover party, 5 boys, 15 hours of nonstop, and like 50.
Yeah.
He didn't sleep all night from 5 o'clock yesterday, and I had a rush here, dropped him off at another play date where he went right to game playing again with his friends, so he was playing for 20 hours. And I think about that, and I think about this discussion about liveness, you know, and how we all are striving for that, and then I try to think, well, 20 years from now, well, for him also, just as dance class, he's in school play, so I think it's good moments to think, and he reads lovely and stuff too. But I think, like, we're talking about art, wanting to have this aliveness and trying to figure out technology, so what we do is theater or performance artists. In the 20 years from now, is it going to mean anything? You know, is it just one part of his life that's going to be a one part of his life 20 years from now? Like, is game playing this to people who are 20 years from now?
Well, look at gameplay. I think we gotta get out of the video game as game. Those game players, they're doing cosplay. Do you guys know about cosplay, you know, costume play, where they're gathering groups all over the world and creating the whole universe that they're playing, and they're in forests with their DIY, you know, shields. That mentality of gaming, part one of the things I worked on was alternate reality gaming, which is all about having digital spaces drive people experiences to improv together. You know what I mean? So I think we can't be fearful that we're going into an all-digital age, because I think we've had a backlash against Sims and Second Life. I think people don't want to just play in that world. They want to be there, find each other, and then congregate in real space too. So I don't think we're going towards that.
But it changes the nature of the congregation.
It does. But where how they don't think of as performers and theater artists, but that's what they're doing.
Well, I mean, Nick, you know, for instance, does come out and play, you know, and River, we worked with them for a couple of years, you know, and what they do is they take game logic from, you know, digital environments and create real life games on the street, you know, and we also work with them about everybody, because, you know, Charlie does amazing stuff. I think, you know, I don't know, it's interesting, like, seeing how these ideas that happen in digital spaces come into live space, and I wonder with that type of thing, like, you know, like, and it's not, this is not like a privileging or anything. I wonder, like, are you going to remember the score you got on a video game, or are you going to remember the friend you're hanging out with playing in their living room?
Right.
And I, like I said, I'm not privileging, I'm just saying, like as experiencing bodies in this, like, as a monkey, you know, all Descartes, right? As a sort of like mind in this body experiencing the physical world a certain way. And I know that there are things that we think we remember that we did. So I'm just sort of curious, what are the issues that are raised around that?
So I think about that a lot with a 9-year-old. Same thing. He is just obsessed. But what I'm starting to realize is that it depends on the game, for one thing. The Mario games, he's on a quest and he's trying to get the princess at the end. It's a dumb story, but, you know, he has skill. And there's an eye hand that he's really good at, and he likes to do it just like I used to like to do layups, you know, on the side. Minecraft, on the other hand, is a whole different thing. I don't know if people know Minecraft, but
he'll spend more time on that, and he'll have other people. They create worlds where, and there's no real quest in that thing. It's kind of, it intrigues me that they're so interested in it. It's crafting. They dig up stuff, they build things. There's enough danger there if you don't get your stuff together and get your torches up in time. You won't live through the night, and that'll teach you. But most of it is just wandering around doing stuff. And it's like, what can we make? And I sometimes feel like I don't necessarily want to pull him off that one as quick, because maybe he's got 21st century work skills there that he's developing better than what at school.
I just wanted to mention it, you know, because it's one of many things he does, and I think one of many things he'll do as he becomes an adult. And I think going to the theater is staying to him, or taking a dance class, or, you know, you can watch whatever. So for us, I think it's different. We grew up with that. We're not trying to figure fit it into our lines, fit it in. He's working the arts.
Mm-hmm. A question just come up all the time about who is the audience, you know, who is the sense audience, how do we live spaces. And I just think a lot of this take cues from that gaming world, where I actually feel that similar to the, you know, if we're talking about the difference between being a participating artist or being an audience member, that there is something to the rehearsal process. There's something to the buildup and the learning process, which is what you were talking about a little bit. You're immediately learning with this new app, this new way to integrate it into your world at large and how to function with your fingers and your mind, and teaching our audience now, this is a room mostly probably full of live theater makers who are wondering who and where that audience is, and just to speak to a little bit, engaging our audience and teaching them new ways of participating in the work before it's complete. I don't think there's so many ways that people are doing this, but I'm curious if you guys are all coming from such different angles. And who are they, how they can participate, what their participation means, you know, how is that, because if we're talking about, you know, a maker system, and then going to all the maker world, of what is it to actually be integrated into the art that you are then receiving? What is that difference, and how can we begin to discuss that as live theater makers?
I do think that we need to reconsider labels like audience, data, simply because these become extremely difficult to articulate when you are thinking about some of these transmedia things, because at different points you are participating, at different points you are the maker, at different points you are a spectator. And I think part of our challenge is to acknowledge that, you know, technology is as much a cultural production. You know, and I think one of our deeply ingrained belief is that technology is something outside of culture. It is not. We are fundamentally technological creatures. And technology, while we make technology, technology makes us. And it's been integrated to us, integrated into our rituals, the way we behave, the way we do things. And so the more we start embracing that this is part of what makes us human, right? Rather than thinking about it as something that is external to us, that we constantly need to justify, constantly need to make excuses for, constantly need to say, well, you know, that's the way it's taken, and it's not going to help us. I genuinely think that if you think about it that way, and you look back at how what we classically talked about as reception, you know, how we receive something, reception has become far more difficult today, like in the simplistic sense of something being generated and you receiving it. And because of different demands on the performers, different demands on the audience, what we use for audiences, because they are looking for very different kinds of experiences, because that's what they get outside of the theater they go to or the performance they are visiting. And so part of it is really for us to continue to acknowledge that these labels are going to be challenging. And it's a good thing simply because we are evolving very different kinds of spectatorship, very different kinds of listening and audience. And I think it's a good thing.
This issue of like how do you locate like the site of the work is really interesting. How do you locate the work is interesting. And I think also in all of these like tools, technologies are really kind of like chipping away at a kind of binary of specialization or depending on what these things are. And I think one thing that I think a lot about too in terms of like, you know, practicing artists and standing there also is how do those things impact how we locate like the actual like work of the artist in the craft and the process? Because, you know, I think like one of the big shifts that like connects to dramaturgy, that connects to form experience is like this massive paradigm shift from say like document or sort of production based or sort of like all like experience to like the two major paradigms now are the cloud and the stream, right? And those are the things that like not only are shaping narrative but also shaping the artistic process. So in that regard, like, you know, I've been to some rehearsals where I love being at the rehearsal far more than I saw that I love being at the workshop.
Yeah.
You know, right? And in that way, it makes me think like, okay, well, you know, works in progress stuff, you know, all of this pressure to be broadcasting or be locating yourself for live is like this strange, I think it's sort of this strange aspect of a kind of like publicity production kind of model. Whereas now I feel like this whole openness is actually, it's not just about like promotion before the event happens, but it's actually about remapping the artistic process so that it, again, it's sort of a spectrum where even at the early stages of your work, it can, maybe that's the work itself. And I also see that it's coming up in like why like discourse-based theater and discourse-based performance is so interesting right now, and why the idea of like conferencing and like conferencing has become such a major force of like, you know, creative and artistic thinking, you know, or, because like it's part of this continuum before you get to product where you could potentially invite people into it.
Sometimes I think that the work in progress should become the unconference, that it should actually just be an open invitation to discuss the themes and the concepts instead of presenting work. What does the work mean and how do we, because it should never be done, and I think that that's something also to take a cue from the startup in the tech world, is that you present an idea and then you receive feedback from your community and you are constantly adjusting the work to suit the needs of that community as they tell you what your value is, they tell you where the idea will be best suited. And I think that that's, I don't know.
It's really counterintuitive to the traditional
right.
product model.
Right.
So, you know, when we produced a play on Broadway, people who bought a ticket needed to know
right.
what they were going
exactly.
to. But I think it's really interesting and healthy to be thinking about, so what's it look like if it's really more about what's happening as the discoveries are being made rather than how well can they execute the locked, repeated thing.
Right.
Yeah, we're trying to unlock that problem, right? So we have a fellowship program where we bring artists in, and part of the responsibility of the artist is first off respond to an innovation challenge that's kind of ironed out in advance. So they start to, their creative process then is the focus of how the work gets presented to the public over a year's period of time. Yes, there's an outcome. It gets to the end and everybody can applaud it and be happy about getting there. But the value added really is in that, in bringing it to the public in a way that's also, for, you know, in a way curated, right? So it locates it. And it's not like I'm looking over the shoulder of someone, because there is a responsibility, I think, for institutions, at least, presenting arts institutions, to contextualize experience. And that becomes part of the discourse. Mm-hmm. So I was talking earlier at the other session, you know, I sort of describe what we do as a kind of platform for discourse, right? It's not a traditional presenting arts institution. So how do you create that flow and bring it forward so that it has a feedback mechanism built into it that informs its evolution as it moves down the pipe?
Well, a really interesting question. I don't know where Andy went, but how does criticism come into play? I mean, it has to be a different type of criticism. It's about the process rather than the opening night review.
Right.
With a complex movement, we did a work in progress residency this past summer in Detroit at the Charlie Trice Museum for African American History, and they never presented a performance work of this nature, you know, experiential, immersive installation environment with projection mapping and game-like experience. And
We had over 20 performances for communities to come and see the work while we're in progress, explicitly to receive feedback. So we wanted to figure out specifically like this question of when you're dealing with technology-based work, like I think it's such a new field. We're all trying to figure out its form together and how to make it, you know, aesthetically engaging and something that can express ideas, you know, coherently as we're learning these new technologies and everything. But what gets lost and what I've seen, because I'll be in a room where there's like 10 people that are like, yeah, I'm doing a technology-based media installation in some immersive environment. But like content-wise, it gets lost.
Yeah.
Like we lose like any like semblance of like cultural equity or community engagement in that process because there's so much to learn just about the form itself right now. So I feel like one of the things we were curious about with our work in progress is like, as we're testing all these tech elements, can we also give an opportunity for communities to, you know, feedback into how to make it still, you know, content-wise relevant, experientially and, you know, accessibility-wise relevant too, because like with these technologies and we're dealing with, you know, communities that may have disabilities and also like having accessible on multiple languages, like, you know, dealing with technologies, how do you make that serve those as opposed to like further alienate communities, you know, from your work. So that was the way that we approached making it like this open work in progress call to be able to engage folks. And we hope to continue doing that with these pre-residencies as we enter communities, you know, for like a week prior to, you know, a year or so prior to like a full engagement where people could co-develop some of the work with us. And again, you know, kind of address this question of like technology's potential elitism by being able to like go directly to communities that usually aren't, you know, the ones at the hackathon or the ones at the, you know, technology, arts and technology centers, you know what I mean, and be able to really start from there and make it a conversation about both those things, both innovating form and, you know, being able to be accountable to our communities in that process.
And I also don't think that the process has necessarily changed in a lot of ways. Like, that Broadway show went through 5 years of development. It may have been different than it was in Chicago, and it was a lot different than the first reading and the second workshop. And I think those iterative processes of continual and constant development is similar in the sort of technologically involved work. But I think what is different now is that the products are less defined. And also there's a larger cultural shift that can't be ignored that's being represented in the manifestation of how people are approaching this work. And there's a collaborative nature to a lot of this work. There's an open source nature of this work. There's a sort of flat, non-hierarchical approach to how we can rethink traditional commercial models to break out the elitism, to make it available and accessible to everybody, to be able to have platforms of participation and co-design, to be able to articulate stories that in a commercial model didn't necessarily have platforms for being able to be developed, recognized, and produced. And I think that's what's exciting.
I'm loving both of your work. I just want to call out that Michael's part of Sandy's storylines, which is a phenomenal kind of storytelling healing process post-Sandy here in New York. And I love he worked with Sasha, Sansa Choke, I mentioned earlier from MIT, who's looking at community activism, and he thinks it's fundamental that the community is part of the design from the beginning when you're looking at trying to create more complex story projects that deal with community. And he's right. He did a project, same storyline coming out of that philosophy, but where he took like some old school motorhome type stuff into communities of migrant workers and dealing with collecting their stories. And originally it was for an active policy thing, but it transformed into a storytelling. They readopted it for their own internal storytelling. That was phenomenal.
For day laborers.
Yeah. For day laborers.
Yeah, it was the question.
And then you were there.
The community engagement thing is a very good way to go about with this. But I found that there are many situations where one needs to deal with the notion of expert, specialized knowledge. And you talked about it very briefly when you said, look, you know, you were speaking in language that people could not connect to. And you are working with platforms that perhaps needs a little bit of training on the part of, I mean, for the people who are bringing the knowledge in to actually train the community to understand what this is in order to intervene and come up with interesting ideas of generating content. But I think that, you know, that needs to be talked about that is another part of this, which is again, speaking about Detroit. I live in Ann Arbor and I do a lot of projects in Detroit. And I've become very aware about a kind of, we want to have the meeting among Detroit residents. And the problem really is that, look, you know, yes, you are welcoming, you're coming in, you want to do something with us and for us, but we really don't want you to come in and help us, because we actually are doing pretty fine for ourselves. So Detroit becomes a stage for someone else's agenda that then gets laid out in the name of community engagement. And I think that there is a kind of a interesting political and ethical question of how we engage communities, especially when the knowledge we bring that needs to somewhat empower them comes from a particular point of view and has some specialized knowledge that makes it very difficult for the community to really engage in, except as in a very secondary fashion. So we need to be thinking about
this. Well, it's interesting when you think about engagement and access, those words, how they fuel each other or how they fight each other. I just think that's really interesting.
One thing that's really interesting about this conversation is the new core of why some of us are in the room is this sense of fear. How live performance is going to survive people. And I think that that's a problem that's been going on for several years. And for me, this could be a conversation about the sustainability of art and culture. And sustainability is intrinsically linked to innovation and creativity from any number of perspectives. So when we think about the dimension of sustainability that's directly related to culture, I'm going to be a little opportunistic at the table here, but I'm wondering if the artists at the table can talk about what they actually need, how they need the infrastructure support in America to change in order to make space for innovation and creativity.
Well, I just want to preface it, or just one thing before we go, is that when the daguerreotype was invented and photography became a thing, painters said that painting would be dead forever. So I just preface the thought of the idea of the death of like an ancient tradition.
And I believe in evolution, not death.
I think your premise is a solid one, but I also want to like challenge that too and reverse it and say, you know, how to pose the question of how can digital whatever and technology survive without live performance and liveness, right? Mm-hmm. Because if anything, we look at the dominant shifts in technology are movements to body, movements to presence, right? So like instead of things ending at terminal surfaces or like a screen that has nothing behind it, that is actually more cathedral-like than anything. It's part of the architecture. It's fixed in granite. You know, mobile, right? The word is mobile, right? So the screens are moving with us. So and you know, perhaps one could say that performance is becoming the dominant paradigm of cultural expression, right? So if these things are maybe happening, how can those things live without us? And I think in terms of like what artists want, and if you reverse that thing, I think part of it is that culture has to really, and artists themselves have to like flip the oppressed mentality that we are marginal, right? And like the funding and the different institutions need to acknowledge that as well, and start supporting the work in ways that don't say like what we're supporting is a product. You know, what should be supported is projects. And you know, so much of this is about like arts and research. The premise of the talk is sort of arts and research, right? Well, research is curious. It's research, you know, it's funded as a process, you know, and it's speculative, and maybe there's a product at the end. And you know, so really like if what could people give us? Like give us think tanks, give us research labs. You know, don't give me like a finishing residency. You know, give me a lab for 2 years.
I think the problem there is give. there's a certain, and I mean this with all due respect, that I think, and not directed at you personally, but we have to be very careful about that the position of the arts as in this sort of antagonistic way relative to the larger culture of creativity.
I think there's real danger in the entitlement that can come from that, and arrogance that can come from that framework. I agree with you totally that there's that convergence is necessary and essential, and that the paradigm is obvious to, I think, most of us probably in this room, that paradigm shift. At the same time, in struggling to find out where in this really complex world that we are situated, where the problems that society, culture, and humanity are facing, from globalization to the environment to sustainability to, you know, to education to the economy. I mean, all these things are so complex and layered and difficult to navigate and urgent. And the arts need to step up to the plate and deliver creative strategies that help us address that world. I believe they can do it. I'm totally committed to creating the research center to give that block. That's what we're trying to do.
Right.
And it is incredibly difficult because the value proposition has to go back to those who will provide the resource. And yes, we can go to Bill. Hey, NEA.
How much was that?
87.
Yeah, that small little piece that of this giant economy. We go to Gartner. We go to technology companies. Go to me. But I think there also has to be a shift in that whole narrative structure. You know, how are we playing in the world? What is this relationship between the economy and the arts that can play out in a very different formula?
Well, this gets back a little bit to kind of what we were talking about today earlier, but also in those summits that we did with the National Science Foundation. And there's an interesting tension that happens early in some of these conversations from both sides, not wanting to just simply be a utility or something. So it's like the arts for art's sake argument is part of that. But it's, at the same time, there's a lot of people, some of the table who actually want to employ this stuff to some specific problem or good. And just in terms of capitalization from a large sector sense, it can be really useful. There's such interest in creativity and technology right now. But how do we build the capacity to use that in a way that's meaningful and makes sense and deeply does something? That's where suddenly the political conversation gets to be very fruitful. And we don't get into these uncomfortable things about entitlement and can't even think of the word, the stuff that, you know, that causes scandal, you know, those kinds of things. It's not, nobody, I mentioned earlier today, nobody's against winning the future on any side of any aisle. And there is a tremendous amount of interest right now in industry and education and broadly general in the population in fostering creativity in a way that really accomplishes things.
Can you speak a little bit more to winning the future? I think that there's a very, when we talk about competition in the arts, competition for resources, I just think that there's an interesting notion that comes with even the concept of winning.
Yeah.
Succeed. And I'm just curious if we can speak a little bit more to that in the context of what you're describing.
So I guess this would be how it would play out in the political landscape. Winning the future is a very sort of maybe high-minded way of saying we need to rally so that we create, in the STEM esteem thing, for example, bringing arts and creativity to STEM, thinking and learning and capability and development, so that we develop competencies for the 21st century that will allow us to have healthy people. I mean, yeah, well, that's what this the interesting thing is, it's the STEM educators that come up with that, and they're interested in creativity and imagination, and they really want to understand. Their problem right now is they know that just memorizing math doesn't equip you to go into a workforce that we don't understand yet because it hasn't been invented. And we know that people need to invent solutions for problems, not from memory. And that becomes a really, I think, just generally, a very tangible and good traction for arguing for why we need to have this lab. You know, because we need to understand ourselves better in terms of how we imagine things, what it means, what kind of sense we make of things, and then how we can apply those skills in others.
Thanks. I just wanted to respond to the conversation and your question of what it is that we can offer in exchange with this lab, because when I came into this conversation, I actually had no idea what this would be. I just know that my greatest fear is that as a playwright, what I do might just end up as a YouTube video. And just being like that is really, I mean, just it's just very different languages. And I feel like the success of film to really reach a really mass audience in the way theater hasn't, has sort of educated a much larger number of people to tell stories in a filmic way. And whenever I work with communities or students and talk in theater and how to tell their stories, what you're getting is television and film narratives. So going to Andy's question of how does this affect things dramaturgically, I think what kind of resonated with me throughout the duration of this conversation was that we were all going back to the very basic elements of what makes theater different to film. The body, the voice, the communal ritual, the participation of the audience, time, space, and all of these other elements that are just not present when we're watching film, yet somehow film is a predominant narrative language that we know, and it is not as, and younger generations, I feel, are less educated on how to tell stories with the body, and in public, and with people in a space where they are present. So in this exchange for the technology, which I think artists need to experiment with to really advance what my plays will not be a YouTube video, but actually theater that maybe is online, I feel like the exchange is to really provide skills and understanding of the basic elements of theater for a generation that doesn't have much access to it as they do to film and TV, which is so pervasive in our culture. And anyway, that's sort of what I want to say.
I just want to give you some scope. One, the 40s Entertainment, which is this alternate reality game production house in Hollywood, they had up to 10 million people playing their alternate reality games, living inside the expanded narrative of, you know, some of these Hollywood properties. So it's still connecting, obviously there's like fanboy stuff, but they had up to 10 million people playing, and those digital experiences drove people in mass to live theater experiences. They might not have said the word theater, but that's what it was. You know, they were playing roles, there were actors there that were telling stories, they were interacting with characters. So I don't know if that's the model, but there is, all these people that are so visually connected and wired that way are craving liveness. They want to be into real spaces. So how do we leverage that that human thing?
I think it's a really great point, is that the language of the cinema, television, the theater, the daguerreotype era, changes everything. And there is this education, an important educational issue there. There's also a huge opportunity because it frees liveness in theater up to not do that.
Yeah.
And to be about something else that it hasn't been about ever before.
Right.
Go, man.
And I mean, because theater, there's thousands and thousands of years and so many multiplicities of practice, and film is a 100-year-old technology, so we're all freaking out about something that happened 20 years ago over an industry that happened 100 years ago, but there's years and years and years of, you know, tools and skills that I feel have, and anyone who is involved in arts education knows it does have tangible impact on individuals, and it does work, and it isn't something that needs to be argued for. It's just, you know, how it's applied.
And part of it is like, how much do you decide to wed theater to architecture, right, of theater? And if you don't agree to that, or you don't believe that, then it gets really interesting. You know, like something that I tell my students is like, okay, pretend like you're a fully trained theater artist. You're getting your MFA. Keep that in there. let's say someone hands you a script. It has words, it has characters, it has locations, but let's pretend no one ever told you that it's supposed to happen in a theater, that someone's supposed to show up at a box office and buy a ticket. Let's say you just forgot how to make theater, but you still have all the tools, the training. Mm-hmm. And you have all the tools that you have around you, besides the architecture of the theater. Mm-hmm. Like, what do you do? Go make something. Right? And when that is handed to people,
yep.
It's pretty amazing because I see full utilization of their theatrical training, mm-hmm. physically, design-wise, artistically, the voice. But they find all of these like many, many forms of communicating stuff, and it gets really exciting. Mm-hmm. And also, if it helps you, you know, like something like our work plays a lot in film festivals and stuff too. And in all these film festivals, you know, their language is getting changed around too, right? Mm-hmm. Because, like, internet and like non-cinematic language is really affecting cinematic production as well. Mm-hmm. And if you look at any festival now, most film festivals have like performance components or
So they plus even like television and the upfronts and all of that, just how things get made and paid for is a big question, because anybody can make it anywhere. So now you have these online channels popping up that are a whole different way of doing things. So they're in the middle of a big shift, too.
Another big shift is how much people want story. We think about it in shortness content, like YouTube, only 3 minutes, people don't know how to tell long story. But on the other side of it, people binge on story. Like now, episodic television is blowing up. People sure. want to live inside the world, they want to be with the characters, not stop. Like I'm very embarrassed to admit that I just read Pride and Prejudice this month. I've never read it before, and I fell in love with this like story, and I didn't realize how much referential all the other stuff that I loved that I had been referencing this book. And then so I went from there to I had to listen to it on tape, although it would work, and I had to watch like 3 movies, very good. And so I'm like, okay, why am I there's something about how we create story in different ways that people need to participate with and live with and love and be in a relationship with character.
And then add to that, like, just the feeling of embodiment and how as an audience, like, I'm always interested in how my relationship to a performance or an event actually can affect it. And so how we restructure narratives so that me as a participant is actually involved in the narrative in a certain way, and then can help shape and move that narrative in a certain direction. So this idea of embodiment is actually, I mean, I'm just hearing a lot of words and I keep in my mind the word embodiment keeps coming up for me. And I always just want to be implicated as an audience member. I don't want to be an audience member, I want to be a participant.
Right.
And I see this sort of top-down storytelling where I'm sitting down and I'm sort of involved in somebody else's thing. And I think this is movies and film and the fourth wall theater as well. Has never been that interesting to me, actually, even though it's been, a format that I've been involved in for many years.
When you said architecture, I was just thinking, when I trained in theater in the late 80s, early 80s, the idea of a thrust stage and how discombobulated it was, how do you direct on that, how do you act on that, and then doing something around, oh my god, So, and now it's like, just a whole new way of finding found space.
You brought up 31 keynotes, and there's a lot of different people working in these new narrative formats, and I think that really the bottom, the real bottom thing is that we are just inherently, a storytelling species. I feel like that's what we need, is we need to engage with people in story, and relate our story and understand other people's story. And so how, and all of these things that we're all doing are just, perversions and permutations of that really fundamental human desire and need. And I feel like in the beginning you said, well, what's human about all this digital stuff? And I think that all of this technology and everything that's part of our lives that becomes, it's going to become more and more part of our lives. It's going to become integrated into our bodies. I mean, it's just the direction that we're going in. It's not really an if, it's just when that's going to, when the biological barrier is actually going to be.
I think the technology and the amount of data and information that is released in this age obviously, overwhelmingly consumed. There's no way that any one person can really go deal with that. But the story is how we deal with that. You know what I mean? The story is how we cognitively, you know, take all this in making meaning out of it. So that's why I think story is more important now than it ever has been. And I'm really interested in that. A lot of we're talking about the new storyteller is a storyteller that can tell the meta story. One example is, which will be at Sundance this year, is I Want You to Want Me. It's a piece that's coming. And it's basically taking all the online dating data that's available, and they used it to congregate beautiful visualization of how human beings really want to connect. And like, what is the humanness about? Why I want you to want me? And they found this beautiful poetic thing out of eHarmony and Match.com. I was like, it seems so disconnected in terms of human, you know what I mean, in some ways. And they found this very amazing human. And it's a meta story. It's not one person's story. It's how we as a species respond to each other.
So I think I mentioned last night, we're doing some research with the Department of Defense, not government, but by the way, Americans don't kill people.
Okay, fair enough. But
it's really been interesting for me to think about how we talk about what we do and why it's important, especially with this program that we're doing with PTSD and TBI. And thinking about in the integrated care environment, why story really matters to them. You just hit it on the head. In some ways, our lit review for this research thing that's going to IRB calls out Aristotle as, you know, he was a man of medicine person. He thought catharsis was really a way to bring intellectual clarity to emotional chaos. And if you think about it, with this big data thing, we're all sort of suffering from some form of mild PTSD. And narratives and stories sort of allow us to kind of chunk that into something that we can connect with and resonate with and go, I get it. And then you can file it away in the memory.
I just want to go back and kind of connect with yours with really what quite a few people have said about the need for story and also the need for more processual awareness of how artists work. Because I feel that less and less people are interested in presenting a representation in the traditional, like, 19th century way of putting a play up. This person is pretending to be someone else, and you're going into this other, you know, narrative place. I think there are a lot of artists, I mean, I shouldn't work this way, a lot of artists in performance that are bringing the performers to the audience as themselves. I mean, they might even be indicating another character to some extent, but then the other half of their presence is what's important. And I don't really represent characters so much. It's much more about them being the performers themselves. But I think that's where this whole idea of process that you brought up, you know, that works much more process-oriented, that's where the interest is. I think that's also kind of where the story is, where the narrative is. For me more and more, but to walk into a live performance space and say, okay, what's the story of how I ended up in this room, how these performers ended up in this room, what are they doing, what question are they asking, how did they get there, what's their process? I think that's a kind of a story that maybe is a different way.
It's almost like an exercise instead of a process.
Perhaps, yeah. Perhaps. Maybe it's just if one thinks of narrative or story as a way of asking a question and perhaps not, you know, resolving it explicitly, but like, you know, working the question through, you know, through representation in an hour and a half computer piece. Perhaps now it's more about a question that gets asked over a 3-year development period, an audience then can participate in some of the findings and also get a sense of it. Yeah.
I'm gonna interject with a story too, which is of the part where we end. But first of all, I want to thank everybody for coming here. I feel I'm very optimistic about the future with all these wonderful, thoughtful people trying to figure out the eternal questions of how we are in the world. I encourage you to connect with these people while we're here.